Carrie Severino joins us now via the phone, and she is with JCN, and she's also the co-author of the best-selling book, Justice on Trial, The Kavanaugh Confirmation and the Future of the Court. We've had her on the program before. Carrie, so good to have you back. I thought your timeline was incredibly insightful, because this does set up a pretty significant Supreme Court challenge if the Supreme Court hears it. So with Kennedy versus Louisiana, do you think do you believe that the court is going to hear this? Is there hesitancy, do you think? Because it doesn't mean it's a guarantee, even if it challenges it.
Yes, although I think in this case, it's going to be the type of case that the Supreme Court would want to hear. Because what would happen is if someone challenges this law, that a state's law would be struck down. And there are some times when it's like, okay, well, one circuit's interpreting some federal statute a little different than another, that they might wait until it becomes a deeper or more serious issue with the conflict before they take it. In this kind of case where you have a state that's presumably going to have its law struck down, I think they feel like they have to take it to make sure that there's not that's only happening when it's absolutely correct. And as you pointed out, this is a case that I think there is a real question as to whether the underlying case is correct, saying that you simply can't have the death penalty in a case of child rape, when it's very clear that in the early years of our republic, when the Eighth Amendment was passed, when it said no cruel, unusual punishment, they did not view punishing someone who had committed, in this case, I mean, it was a brutal, brutal rape of this man's, I think it was stepdaughter, 8 years old, really shocking, had to have emergency surgery to repair some of the physical damage, really outrageous. So the idea that this somehow our founding fathers would not have thought that was totally appropriate, that's not cruel and unusual, that is justice in that case, it's just not true.
Yeah, and you noticed this as well. We're talking with Carrie Severino. You can find her on Twitter at JCN Severino. You noted that you were horrified. You said, I still remember being horrified when Justice Stevens asked a bizarre question to the assistant district attorney to clarify that the 8-year-old gruesome rape victim didn't have any permanent injury. That was sort of the reasoning that some of those who wanted to ban the death penalty for being used in this, they thought that you had to have permanent injury in order to substantiate that penalty?
Yeah, I mean, hello. Permanent injury, it's hard to even begin, especially as a mother with daughters, you know, but anyone can imagine. How could you not have permanent injury? And of course, that was part of the response, was like, of course, I mean, yes, eventually she was able to recover from her physical injuries. Although, I don't believe that there weren't even longstanding repercussions just to the surgery alone. But the idea that raping a child like that would not result in permanent injury is insane and you know, heartless.
Yes. And I love that you noted that Justice Breyer was forced to admit that there were a lot of horrible crimes that, you know, had been, you know, that hadn't for the prior 43 years, at least, you said, been eligible for the death penalty. And how Scalia jumped in to note, yeah, actually they did. They did execute people for those things. And Breyer had to agree. Yes, they actually did. That's correct. It was very, you said it was a very revealing moment, which I mean, I was fascinated by your timeline, because it really gave insight into, you know, what kind of interpretation Breyer and some of these other justices were embracing. But now, when we look at the makeup of the court, it has changed. And it's interesting that those who were dissenting, you know, there's still some of those justices there, whereas the others, they're no longer on the bench. So this could be a very different outcome.
Absolutely. I mean, Justice Alito wrote the dissent, the Chief Justice, Justice Thomas, are all still at the court. And it's really a clash of two different ways to look at this. I mean, so we have the Eighth Amendment, no cruel and unusual punishment, right? Mm-hmm. What does that mean? Does it mean what it meant when it was passed? If so, it's clear that not just child rape, but there's a lot of things at the time they would have said, you know, yeah, those are serious punishments. But that's not what we're talking about. They were talking about things like drawing and quartering and torture, you know, things that now we can't even imagine a modern country doing. But that was the kind of stuff happening in England that they were responding to, right? So they were talking about something very differently. Now you've got this other version, which Justice Breyer was embracing there, but which the Kennedy versus Louisiana opinion embraced. And there are still justices who say, well, yeah, but that's a moving target. That's a changing standard. So if now we have more and more states that are saying, well, maybe you can't have the death penalty for rape. Maybe you can't have it for child rape. Maybe you can't have it for these things. Their idea is, once enough states, or as many states as they feel like, because there's no real clear number, once we feel like, well, we've moved beyond that, now it's unconstitutional. And that's a very different way of looking at it. I think you can amend the Constitution. We certainly could say it, make that a different standard and say we won't run any death penalty.
Oh, exactly.
But you have to amend it. You don't get a justice to just say, I think that's beyond the pale. I don't think we should be able to do that. That's not how our Constitution is amended.
We're talking with Carrie Severino with JCN. You mentioned the changing standards. As I've seen it discussed on, you know, some left sites as well who've been noting this, the evolving standard of decency. I kind of find that weird in the society that we have, that people would make an appeal to that the evolving standard of decency, considering, you know, some of the stuff that we're dealing with, for instance, in classrooms, etc. Really, we're gonna cite that as a reason to not approach this?
Yeah. Well, and it's something that I think Justice Scalia brought up in the arguments as well of like, well, in that theory, what if countries said, hey, you know, we're going to eliminate the death penalty for certain crimes, and then they went back the other way. Hmm. Now do you take that into consideration as well? And I think that's a real problem, because what the people on the one side of this case want to do is create this one-way ratchet, because they just want to get rid of it altogether. And okay, fine, that's a fine policy position to have, but this is not a legitimate way to go about that process, is to say, well, my view is the evolved way of looking at, you know, yeah. It's like, I'm so enlightened. No, we'll look at and see what the Constitution actually says. And again, you can make an argument for let's amend that. And you can make an argument if you're a citizen of Louisiana and say, you know, I don't think our state should punish raping an underage child so brutally that she has to have emergency. I don't think that should be punished with the death penalty. Ugh. Fine, make that argument. But don't try to make the judges import their own personal decisions into the actual language of the Constitution.
There were some that were criticizing the change. From what I understand, the law that was signed requires an 8-4 decision to impose the death penalty instead of a unanimous vote once the defendant has been convicted. Is that, how significant of a change is that? Because I see some people who I don't know if they're just overreacting or if this is like a serious, you know, what is your thought on that? Because previously it had been a unanimous vote in order to carry this out. Now it's an 8-4. I would just think something as serious as child rape. I mean, usually these cases are not, I've never seen a case that's been incorrect. I mean, maybe I'm wrong on this, but I wanted to get your thoughts.
Well, you know, You do have to obviously make sure that we are including due process rights for those accused, because as horrible as child rape is, it's also be horrible to be falsely accused of that, whether you're, you know, executed or not. Right. So we want to make sure there are extra safeguards. And so generally there are, when you have a criminal or a capital potential offense here, it has often a higher standard. And I think there are some arguments back and forth of, does it have, it doesn't say in the Constitution it has to be unanimous, but historically it often has been. And so I think there are people who will make arguments back and forth of whether there is an implication that you do have to have a unanimous jury for that. So that's a separate question. I think it's very clear that at the founding era, again, this and a lot of other horrific crimes, and some crimes that today we would be kind of like, oh, we wouldn't want to have the death penalty for that.
Right.
That was the backdrop that they were operating on. So they wanted to limit what they would have said, called cruel and unusual punishments, but that doesn't necessarily mean never using the death penalty. In fact, they would have definitely had the death penalty for a lot of cases. And it doesn't necessarily mean that whatever our 21st century views are is what, you know, the founders were doing in the 18th century. So we have to, you know, our states can have the flexibility where the Constitution doesn't set limits. The states do have the flexibility to make those choices. And so they can choose to have it or not to, but the Constitution shouldn't be invoked to limit the states in ways that that are just not there in the document itself.
That's a great point with all of this. Last question. We're talking with Carrie Severino with JCN. I know I'm going to be fascinated in watching how the court handles this and how this is argued and what decision they come to when it happens. And so that's the big question. How long does it take before, because they're from what I understand, they're going to have to ask for a review of the ruling, et cetera, and then go forward from there. So what does a timeline potentially look like on something like this?
Well, this is, you know, any Supreme Court case is a long timeline. Cause like, if they accept a case in, you know, January. They might not hear it till the following fall, and then they might not hear the case till the subsequent June. We're talking even longer out than that, though, because this is a law that hasn't yet even been challenged, to my knowledge. I think it will be, but I don't think they've even started the case. So what would happen is you'd have to challenge that case. It's going to have to go through a trial court. That decision could take, you know, who knows, years, right? And then an appeals court has to decide it. That those could take a huge range of length of time, too. And then the Supreme Court would have to take it. So now in a case like this, you can imagine it going quickly because it is the Supreme Court precedent is very clear and binding. I mean, what Florida has done is clearly contrary to the decision in Kennedy versus Louisiana. So you don't have to do a lot of fact finding on the details. You can just say, oh, look, the Supreme Court said you can't do this. You can't do this. Then pass it on up. And then the 11th Circuit, the Court of Appeals, is going to say, oh, yep, the Supreme Court said you can't do it.
Yep.
Pass that up. So I think it would go faster than a typical, but we still could be talking about years before the Supreme Court would actually rule.
It's so good to see some of these challenged, some of these cases challenged, because, I mean, you know, there can be bad rulings. I mean, argued like Roe was, you know, bizarrely argued on a privacy issue, which was, I still will never understand how that even passed the muster, but, you know, it did. So it's good to see some of these being challenged. And of course, we'll see how this, we'll see how this plays out. But I so enjoyed your insight into this, because that had to have been a bizarre thing to go through. You're listening, you know, you're listening and following this case. You're clerking for Justice Thomas, and it's you have justices asking, well, is it, were they permanently damaged though? Because then you can have permanent damage without actually seeing it or having it physically. So that was, I'm so glad that you noted that. Carrie Severino, JCN Severino on Twitter. Always so good to have you. Thank you so much, Carrie, for your insight into this.
All right. Have a good day, Dana.
You too. Take care.